But like so many of us, I became all caught up in the hype. We were successful, we were this internet company, we were gonna take over the world. And that has been the downfall of so many companies. So on that note, I want you to just take a quick look at these logos on the screen. Just think to yourself, what do you think that they have in common? Dead, gone, out of business? So all those are true. I mean, obviously these companies suffered greatly. And I gotta tell you, it really bothers me because behind each logo were real families and real communities that were devastated because leaders failed to reinvent. And that's exactly what happened. They didn't adapt, they didn't evolve, they didn't innovate. The other thing that really strikes me is that each of these companies were once the dominant player in their field. They were the rock stars in their industry. So the lesson to me, it's so specific and powerful. It's that no matter how great our last quarter was or our last year's results, we can't become intoxicated by our own success. In fact, success is a temporary condition, not a permanent state, that happens in the context of many external factors that today are changing at a rate like none other in history. So I want to show you an example of how fast this stuff is happening today and how the world is moving so dramatically, and also how none of us, no matter how successful, are immune. Gillette, probably know, the dominant player in razor blades. They have a 70% market share, billions of dollars of advertising. So you might say, how could somebody possibly compete with Gillette? I want to show you how one entrepreneur is taking them head on, not through more money or resources, but through more creativity. So this guy, his name is Mike, he starts a business. By the way, this is not a Saturday Night Live skit. Real guy, real company. And he says, all right, I'm gonna take Gillette head on. So he launches this company, he spent only $4,000 to produce the video, more than half of which went to rent a warehouse that you saw wasn't even his. So he launches this video, spends $0 in paid advertising. But because the message was so powerful, the world took notice. By the end of the first week that this video launched, it had been seen by 3 million people around the world. By the end of that same week, Mike had 17,000 paying customers. In a mature industry with a dominant market leader, in a commodity field, at a teeny little price point. If that type of disruption can happen to Gillette, to us, that represents our biggest opportunity and our biggest threat all in one. So I want to challenge you for a minute today. No matter what your business card says, CEO of managed services company or IT provider or software engineer, I think we need to add an implicit unwritten title, that of disruptor or innovator or business artist or entrepreneur. Because what's happened is that creativity, innovation, these have become the currency of success. We know that in these challenging times, there's no way we can keep doing things the old way and expect to win. Today, an entirely new set of skills are needed in order to meet the challenges of the day. So, we're gonna dive into five specific ideas. What I found in talking to innovators, and by the way, research on the book, I talked to about 200 thought leaders, billionaires, CEOs, nonprofit leaders, military leaders, artists, musicians, you name it. I found this amazing common threads. Even though they're in different fields and different geographies, there were these commonalities, which is what I wanted to share with you today, the five obsessions of innovators. And our third obsession of innovators is that innovators are obsessed with defying tradition. They hate saluting the flag of tradition. They want to defy it. One of my favorite examples of this is this guy. This guy's named Masoud Hassani. Masoud grew up just outside Kabul, Afghanistan. And as a kid, he saw some just horrible tragedies, largely due to landmines. In the desert region by his home, this was a real problem. In fact, it's a real problem in our whole world. Turns out there's 110 million of these killing machines on our planet. They kill 20,000 people a year, injure many times more. So as a boy, he said, I gotta do something about this. This is ridiculous. I'm gonna commit my life to making a change. The thing is, he could have followed a traditional path. The traditional way to clear landmines has been done about the same since the 1960s. It's expensive, it's dangerous, it's not all that effective. So here's what he did. He said, I'm going to defy tradition. And he came up with his own invention. He calls it the mine cafon. In his native language, that means mine exploder. And what this thing is, it's about 6 feet tall, and there are light bamboo rods that come from the core, and at the end of each bamboo rod is a clay disc. So these things end up being light enough to be wind-propelled. So they blow across the desert floor, kind of like how tumbleweed would blow across the desert floor. So they're light enough to be driven by wind, but the clay discs are heavy enough to detonate the landmines beneath the surface. The result? Profound. Not dangerous at all, far more effective, and over 100 times less expensive per landmine cleared than traditional means. The design made such an impact that it's now on permanent display at the Museum of Modern Art in New York City. He did accomplish this by following the traditional route and making some incremental change. He accomplished this by completely defying tradition. A couple other fun examples, because innovation, reinvention, creativity, it doesn't only apply to our product or service. It can apply to other aspects of our business. How do we conduct our Monday morning meeting? How do we create an experience that resonates with our customers and separates us from the competitive set? Here's a fun example. I know all of us are on airplanes all the time, and airplanes are almost indistinguishable. You hardly remember which airline you're on half the time. Unless you're in South Africa, flying Kalula Airlines, you might notice a slight difference. So Kalula doesn't take themselves so darn seriously. And in this case, they didn't reinvent their product, which is flying people around in airplanes. They reinvented the customer experience. They wanted to have a personality. And there's just no way you could confuse a Delta flight with a Kalula flight. It's just not gonna happen. So this type of creativity, this type of experiential advantage goes way beyond the paint room. Here are some actual phrases that have been overheard on Kalula flights. We're pleased to announce that we have some of the best flight attendants in the industry. Unfortunately, none of them are on this flight. Please be aware, our toilets are fitted with smoke detectors as well as video cameras for the captain's in-flight entertainment. So, in an era, in an industry that has been plagued with bankruptcy, Kalula not only gets a chuckle, but they outperform. This airline has enjoyed double and triple digit growth every year for a decade straight. It's not because they conform to tradition, it's because they defy it. Speaking of experiences, this is the Children's Hospital at the University of Pittsburgh. Now, their customers are sick kids and their families. The folks that run this hospital, the leadership team, wanted to create a better experience. They wanted to better serve their community. And these weren't the docs, these were the leaders of the hospital. So they couldn't mess with the medical care, i.e. their product. So they said, how can we reinvent? How can we innovate and do a better job for our customers? How did they do it? These are the window washers. Here's a quick video that explains the thinking and ultimately the impact that this creative leap drove. Check it out. It's really powerful stuff. The interesting thing is the cost of the hospital system, zero. They came up with the idea, the window cleaning company happily bought the uniforms, and it worked for everybody. No productivity drop, better for the kids, obviously, better for the leaders because now they're able to serve their community in a more compelling way. It's even better for the window washers who were previously doing a fairly mundane task and now have meaning and purpose to their work. For you, the next time you're faced with a challenge, and we're faced with challenges all the time, big and small, I want you to consider this. Our instinct may be to throw money or people or resources or bandwidth at the problem. Try throwing your imagination at it. You may end up with a far better result. was mentioned, I started my career as a jazz musician. And when I was studying music, I had a teacher that would force me to remove strings from my guitar. Sometimes I'd have to remove three, which is half of the strings from the instrument. So you would think with less resources, you'd probably be less creative. Totally the opposite happened. When I had fewer strings on the guitar, I was actually able to break free from traditional patterns. It forced me to look at the work in a different way. And I was able to solve musical problems in a completely fresh approach. So again, getting scrappy, having fewer resources, sometimes can be a real driver of progress. As I was building my company, I got to a point and I wanted to share the wealth with our team. We had a great quarter. The problem is I added up the numbers and all I could afford to give was about 200 bucks a person. Not a very exciting bonus. So I had to get scrappy. I had fewer resources, I had to get scrappy. Here's what I did. It was a Thursday, I unplugged the servers, turned off the phone system, and said, guys, I'm kidnapping the company. I took everybody to the closest Best Buy, gave each person a $200 gift card, and said, you have to spend this right now. So pandemonium erupts. People are racing up and down the aisles. Oh, did you get the camera? Did you get the Xbox? Those poor cashiers at Best Buy, we had like 300 people just attacking them. But the point is this. If I gave everyone that bonus, it would have been forgotten 10 minutes later. But 18 months later, people were still talking about the day that we kidnapped the company. We got scrappy. Another fun example of this. I was thinking one day about how often greatness is achieved in the face of adversity. You know, what would Austin Powers be without Dr. Evil? Or you have great sports rivalries or political rivalries. In our company, by 2004, 5 years in, we were the dominant player in our field. We were crushing our competitors. And we really didn't have some evil arch enemy to gun against, to push us, to fight the hard fight. So since we didn't have a giant competitor, I made one up. I want to introduce you to our fake, fictitious, made-up nemesis, the Slither Corporation. So I had this big company meeting and I said to everyone, listen, there's a competitor out there. They're bigger than us. They're faster than us. They're more technically savvy. They're better financed. And everyone's jaws dropped. They thought we were the big guys in town. So this made-up competitor became part of our culture. It wasn't done to make us feel good. It was done to drive urgency, to get away from complacency. Here's what we did. We really had fun with it. Our spies would intercept memos from the Slither Corporation. We'd get Wall Street Journal clippings of their earnings report to drive us on. We sometimes dressed up in costumes that were the antithesis of our culture. Anyway, what happened though is it also drove creativity and free thinking. So for example, before Slither, I would ask a question like, hey, how can we shorten our production time? People would clam up. They don't want to say the wrong thing. They don't want to piss somebody off. But so then we changed the question. We said, our spies at Slither just got a report. Slither just shaved 2 days out of their cycle time. How do you think they did it? Now, the whiteboards were filled with ideas because no one had any fear. No one was afraid what they were going to say. And so it really drove not only urgency, but it drove our creative thinking. I know each of us have our own real competitors, but I would like to challenge you. Think about what would the ideal competitor be if they were gunning right after you? If Mark Zuckerberg, Warren Buffett, and Bill Gates put $1 billion together, opened up shop just down the street, and had your picture on their target, what would they do differently? How would they approach the work? They're never gonna have a down quarter. It's a really fun exercise to create your ideal competitor and then benchmark yourself against that rather than the actual folks in the real world. One thing I want you to think about from a tool standpoint is looking for that type of breakaway advantage, a 10x advantage. As a venture investor, and I've seen about 3,000 entrepreneurial pitches, it's almost like get to live Shark Tank. But anyway, we often ask ourselves, is there a 10x advantage? In other words, if you're going to launch a PayPal alternative that's only 2% better, forget it. PayPal will win. For us to fund a company, we have to look at ourselves and say, all right, do they have something that's got a 10x advantage? Could be a product advantage, could be a tech advantage, could be a customer service advantage. But there's got to be a real breakaway advantage to crack through the difficult gravity that can hold us back. of my favorite entrepreneurs. This guy's named Tom Licks, L-I-X. So Tom's had a bit of a checkered past. He's had more failures than successes. So anyway, he raises some money, starts a company, goes for it, and it totally craters. This guy blows it. He loses everything. All his investors lost every penny. Tom is broke. He's about to lose his house. What would most people do in this scenario? Run for the hills of safety. Go take some soulless desk job for the rest of their lives. Not Tom. Tom thinks at this moment, at his lowest point, he says, I'm gonna start a whiskey company. Apparently he loves whiskey. Who doesn't, I guess, but Tom really loves whiskey. Actually, he was trained in the military. He was in the military at a young age. An officer showed him how to make hooch. So now he likes to say he's government trained in the field. So here's what Tom does. He gets into the research and realizes that to make a good whiskey takes a decade or more. Tom didn't have a decade. Tom is about to lose his house. So he goes for this 10x push the boundaries approach. He said, wait a minute. Instead of putting the whiskey in the barrels to age, what if I put the barrels in the whiskey? So here's what he does. He takes these giant stainless steel tanks and then he chops up uniform pieces of charred oak wood barrel, puts them in the tank with the liquid, and then he applies pressure. Turns out that this wood is very porous, like a sponge. So when you apply pressure, it soaks up the liquid, and when you release the pressure, the liquid flows back out and it picks up the flavor profile of the wood. So what he does is he applies pressure, releases it, applies it, releases it. So instead of making a good whiskey in a decade or more, Tom is making whiskey in a week. So you might say, all right, he's making it in a week. He's probably gonna hide that fact. He's gonna call it like Kentucky bourbon and blend in on the shelf. Not Tom, he pushes the boundaries. Tom's product is Cleveland whiskey, it's his hometown. Right on the label, radically different. So he's making it in week, he's making it in Cleveland, it's gotta be the discount product. Not Tom, this product sells for a 30% premium to the national brand. And here's what's going on. Even in a week, Tom can't make this stuff fast enough to keep up with demand, running three shifts a day. It's the hottest whiskey product out there. It's won all these blind taste tests. Tom is back on his feet. He's killing it. And he did this because he had the guts, the fortitude, the grit, the determination, the passion to push the boundaries. Started with once great companies that were innovative in their day but failed to reinvent. They didn't embrace these principles, and today they show up on some guy's slide deck. That's not the fate for us. The opportunity for each of us here, my fellow IT leaders, our opportunity is to bust through that. It's to reinvent. And now is the time. Let's use today as a jumping off point. It's an opportunity to shed conventional wisdom, to let our creativity soar, to bring our most imaginative ideas to the forefront, to drive innovation, to reinvent, and in turn, with partners like ConnectWise, ultimately to seize the enormous opportunity that's waiting for all of us just outside those doors. Thank you so much.